Garev Publishing International presents Theft of the Master by Edwin Alexander, read by Alex Jennings. Prologue, January 1493. Archaeology of a Murder. January 1493. Martin Luther is 10 years old. Michelangelo is 18. In Milan, Leonardo is designing a flying machine. Richard Plantagenet, smiling villain, is dead. The Wars of the Roses have ended, and Henry VII rules Tudor England. Alexander Borgia, Pope Alexander VI, thief, adulterer, multiple murderer, and vicar of Christ, rules the one true church. Estonia, remotest and wildest of the Baltic states, is in the 200th year of foreign domination, which will persist for 5 centuries more. In Tallinn, Estonia's capital, icicles drip from the eaves of the Church of the Holy Spirit. Inside, breath smoking in the frozen air, Heinrich Schenk, trader in amber, leader of the town council, kneels before the altar. The cold stone floor is hard on aging knees, but strong in the faith, he makes no complaint. He is tall and sturdily built, rather worn by his 60 years, but with grave presence. His round, fleshy face, heavy brow, and deep-set eyes mark his German ancestry. An austere man, his one weakness is for elaborate and expensive dress. In acknowledgement of the evening's ritual importance, he wears a floor-length robe of burgundy silk velvet, deeply pleated across the chest and with balloon sleeves. He prays for a safe journey. Prayer is his travel insurance. He will follow the familiar yet hazardous route of the amber trade, but his purpose this time will be different. On behalf of his wife, Maria, he will commission a masterpiece. A month's arduous journeying later, Heinrich arrived in Krakow, then capital of Poland. In the town's finest private residence, he followed a young serving girl through rush-strewn corridors to the Spartan workroom of one of Europe's greatest sculptors. It was long, narrow, and undecorated, furnished only with a small writing desk, 2 chairs, and a side table bearing the remains of a meal. Giant logs smouldered ineffectually in an enormous fireplace. Stone dust and the smell of sweat hung in the smoky air. The servant nervously announced, "Herr Schenk from Tallinn, sir," and backed out quickly, her wooden-soled tread receding to leave the room in thick silence. On the hearth, a large and shaggy-coated dog got to its feet, looked at Heinrich curiously, stretched its muscular body, then, with a groan, rearranged itself for sleep. At the far end of the room, a block of raw stone was set on a heavy wooden table, and Weitstor stood before it, his back to the door, in operatic pose, erect, right foot half a stride ahead of the left, head thrown back, hands clasped behind him, motionless as the stone itself. Heinrich waited. Despite meticulous preparations, he had suffered a particularly taxing journey. Scarcely a dozen miles from Tallinn, fording a swollen river, he had almost drowned. Then, after surviving the routine hazards of bears, wolves, bitter weather, and sketchy navigation to reach Warsaw, an uncharacteristically rash encounter with a street vendor's mutton pie had delayed him by 3 days spent mainly on a commode. And finally, in deep forest, only a few miles short of Krakow, he had narrowly escaped an attempted kidnapping by brigands. Perversely, these experiences had produced in him an inner calm, which enabled him to view his host's calculated rudeness with amused detachment. At last, Stoss turned and shuffled to confront his visitor. He was a bulky, round-backed figure, dressed in an ankle-length, shapeless grey smock, which flapped around him as he moved, like a mainsail close-hauled. Despite the chill of the stone floor, his feet were bare. His face, grey as his smock, was coarse, heavy-jowled, the eyes deep and angry. On each cheek was a purple scar, branded there by the authorities of his home city of Nuremberg, a punishment for counterfeiting. Yet he could count himself fortunate, since a less prominent man would have been castrated.
Schenk, that is a good German name.
Stoss spoke with a strong South German accent.
My family originated in Hanover. I had a servant from Hanover, an idle cur. But you have journeyed from Tallinn?
I am Estonian.
Stoss gestured derisively.
Nothing of value has come from Estonia. Subject people, without culture.
He began a slow tour of inspection around Heinrich, muttering under his breath, now in Polish. Having completed his circuit, he faced Heinrich once more.
Why are you here?
Heinrich's amused detachment was wearing thin.
I have come to commission a carving.
Stoss turned away, went to the side table, poured himself wine, and sat down.
Do you know my fee?
No.
Stoss tilted back his chair, stretched out heavy legs, and stared across the rim of his cup at his dirty, naked feet.
I have many commissions,
he said morosely, as though the work were a burden. This was enough. Heinrich, now neither amused nor detached, crossed to the table, poured himself a beaker of wine, dragged a heavy wooden chair to face Stoss, and sat down.
I wish for a carving of Christ, seated, preaching. It is to be carved in wood. Can you make such a thing?
Stoss shrugged.
I can make anything,
he said calmly. He drained the beaker and refilled it extravagantly, splashing wine onto the table, then drank, the liquid seeming to fall down his throat as into a drain.
This carving, is it to be large?
Heinrich gestured to indicate the height.
Seated, you say?
He refilled and drained the beaker once more, set it down, and looked questioningly at Heinrich, who said nothing.
Preaching while seated,
he muttered doubtfully. Heinrich's response was firm.
As the gospel teaches, seated he taught them, sedens docebat eos. John chapter 8, verse 2.
Overwhelmed by biblical authority, Stoss wiped wine from his chins and pointed to the table in the bay.
I have a very fine piece of Stracciacario marble.
Wood,
said Heinrich.
Wood,
repeated Stoss solemnly. And, Heinrich continued, a text, to be inscribed in German on the base.
The truth will make you free. John chapter 8, verse 32.
Stoss sat up, picked up his beaker, made to refill it, then put it aside and instead seized the bottle by its neck as if to throttle it.
Very well, my much-travelled Hanoverian friend.
A gurgling drink from the bottle, then, to Heinrich's surprise, a warm smile.
I will create for you a masterpiece.
On the final word, delivered in an echoing bellow, he stood up abruptly, tipping his chair to the floor with a crash. The sleeping hound raised its tousled head and stared at him reproachfully. Suddenly Stoss appeared more than a little drunk. Swaying, clutching at the table for support, he drained the bottle as a libation to his own magnificence.
Stoss ego ipse,
he proclaimed, jabbing a solid forefinger into his chest while gesturing splendidly with the bottle.
Christum sedentum bellissimum sculperam.
6 months later, sweltering in the August heat, Heinrich sat alongside his wife Maria, daughter of one of Estonia's oldest families, in the Schenk family pew in Tallinn's Church of the Holy Ghost. Maria's great-grandfather's great-grandfather died in the 1343 St. George's Day uprising, and at last the family and the nation have a memorial, a national icon. Now, before a passionately nationalistic congregation, the bishop consecrated Stossi's masterpiece. On its base was carved the text, Wahrheit macht frei. At the insistence of the Tallinn authorities, Maria had reluctantly agreed to the use of German. And this masterpiece, itself commemorating an ancient slaughter, 5 centuries later, will become the trigger for bloodshed and betrayal.